Hello and welcome. My name is Jonathan Vita, and we're going to be discussing in this video philosophy papers as a matter of explanation. So we're going to look at the art of explanation in a philosophy paper. So an overview of what we're going to cover in this video. First, we're going to discuss just some broader goals that every philosophy paper should accomplish. Then we're going to talk about just some general description of the structure of assignments in this course, what the papers will require, some required elements of each. Then I'm going to explain a method of representing arguments, specifically how to put them in standard form. Then I'll look at some more requirements regarding explanation. So this is going to include how premises support a conclusion and spelling out exactly how the premises do so, and then also how the argument fits in the broader article. So, the goals of an explanation paper. Every paper has a purpose. It has a goal that it's aiming for, a target that it's trying to hit. And so, when we look at a philosophy paper, it has specific things that it's trying to accomplish, specific things that are just outside the scope of what it's trying to accomplish. Usually, philosophy papers are not geared toward reporting empirical data. Sure, it might rely on it, but it's not the point. Instead, it's going to be analyzing concepts, explaining arguments, critiquing arguments, and so on and so forth. So it's a very qualitative and analytic approach. It's far less quantitative and data-driven. So all philosophy papers should follow some basic guidelines. It should satisfy the following conditions. For one, it should strive to the utmost to be clear. Words should be used in their normal sense. Sentences should be constructed in a way that are absolutely transparent to the reader. It should be clear what the author is trying to accomplish in the paper. It should not be difficult to find out what the author's position is, what their goals are, and how they're accomplishing their task. Clarity, clarity, clarity. Strive to be clear. Now, this comes as like a double-edged sword. For one, it is very abundantly obvious to your audience, if you have clarity, what you're accomplishing and how well you succeed. So, if you are convincing someone, it is very, very straightforward how you are going about doing so. But on the other hand, it also kind of exposes your weak points. Namely, if you are clear, then you are saying what you are actually being committed to. And if you're committed to a certain position, or if you are exposing different assumptions that you have for the discussion, for what you're doing, somebody might go, oh, that's what's wrong with your argument. You rely on this crucial claim that turns out to be false. So if you're clear, you can be very effective in getting your point across. But if you're clear, somebody also has no confusion over what you mean and what's at stake and how they differ from you. Clarity is absolutely paramount. So this means and the word choices that you use, the sentence structures that you have, the structure of the essay as a whole, how the paragraphs are structured and how they're arranged in a linear way. In every way, your examples are solid, they're spot on. Clarity is aiming for all of these things so that the reader knows right away what you're getting at. This is very, very difficult. And it's where everyone, including myself, where everyone should focus their majority of their efforts. Now, this also requires that you also be concise. By concise, I mean use words economically. That is, the fewest words to convey your point as possible. So you want your sentences to be rich, so that every word counts. You don't fill it with fluff. You say what you need to say, and you move on. So clarity and conciseness, or concision, are not necessarily opposed to one another. Clarity requires that you be full in your explanation and you are abundantly clear. And that may mean saying more than the audience needs to know. And so there could be a way to bring conflict with conciseness. But conciseness means get rid of fluff, make sure that you get right to the point. Don't beat around the bush. Don't create a foggy, vague haze around your points. Say exactly what you mean and get right to it. Coherence. This one is so much harder to try to accomplish. So coherence has to do with not just consistency, but how well everything fits together. How well everything fits together. So the idea here is that when you make a claim, you not only are not inconsistent so that you don't contradict yourself later. Like if you say at one point something like, I believe all morality is subjective, and then later say something like, it's only right that the woman should choose, or it's only right that someone pursue happiness. Those obviously are not compatible, because if it's entirely subjective, then what is this claim actually coming from, that you have some standard of right or wrong now? So coherence has to do with how well everything fits together. Not only are you contradicting yourself at different points, but also how well does everything fit together? Does your paper include all of the things you need to include and none of the things that you don't need to include? So that means get rid of tangents. If you feel like it should belong in like a footnote, or if you feel like it's kind of like a side comment, just get rid of it. It's not going to contribute to your paper. It's going to create your paper in a very weird way. It could become kind of like a Frankenstein's monster where you've got all these different appendages that don't belong to each other naturally, but you instead have like sewn it together in a single file, a single body. Avoid that. Everything that is in your paper should belong in your paper, where it's obvious how it fits, why it's said, to what extent it was useful that you said it, and so on. Now, if you go into an English department, they teach you how to write excellently. And a lot of what people learn in English departments is how to be eloquent, how to communicate your words in the most effective, but also in an emotive or rhetorical way. And that's totally fine. So being eloquent, like using words that really move your audience, that's fine. I would say it's optional. If you have eloquence but you don't have clarity, you're doing it wrong. It's a would like to have. Empirical evidence. You might find in many different sciences, if you're getting a paper, you got to report on some data. You got to bring in some statistics. You got to bring in some studies in order to show that your conclusion, blah, blah, blah. In philosophy, it may be a would like to have. If you're bringing in an empirical study, but you don't have coherence, you're doing it wrong. So if you have eloquence and empirical data, that's nice. But if I see it and the first three C's, clarity, conciseness, coherence, are insufficient, you have majored in the wrong thing. You're majoring in the minors. You should be focusing on something else. So I would actually even say, don't even bother getting empirical evidence. In this course, you don't need it. You are primarily focusing on conceptual analysis. That is, you're taking an idea, explaining it out, looking at certain implications or things that follow from the claims. So you don't need to look at data, because a lot of it is figuring out what we mean here, what follows from a certain principle. And no matter how much data you're going to bring in, it's not going to inform you exactly how the principle follows or how the principle is to be applied per se. So eloquence and empirical data, only after you satisfied the other three C's. Okay, so there are three papers, and the first one I'm going to give, that's the primary focus of this video, is an explanation paper. So an explanation paper not just has clarity and conciseness and coherence, but it has certain elements, these three core elements. The first is to put an argument in standard form, which I'll be describing soon. Then you want to explain each of the premises. That is, you're going to spell out exactly what is meant in the argument that was given in standard form. Then you want to give a summary of that argument and how it fits in the broader context in which it appears. So, for example, I could give the argument from Judith Jarvis Thompson about, if an innocent human being, I'm sorry, if an action terminates the life of an innocent human being, then it's immoral. Abortion is the an action that kills an innocent human being, therefore it's immoral. Now, she puts forward that argument not because she believes it, but as a standard representation of a pro-life argument. And so you could, in a very straightforward way, give the argument, just as I've given, and then explain premise one, why people would believe, why it would be motivated, why would it would be plausible to accept the first premise, that if an action terminates the life of an innocent human being, then it would be immoral. And then also, in a separate paragraph, explain the second premise, that abortion is one of those kinds of actions. But then the last element would be summary of the argument's context in the article. So I would be explaining how that argument, at the beginning of Thompson's paper, is actually used as a foil or an example that she can poke holes into. She doesn't believe the argument, but it sets up an example of an argument people accept, and it's used as a way to undermine the pro-life argument in her paper. So the summary of the argument in the context of the article is, here's what Thompson's doing in the article. She's arguing against abortion, she's giving all these different thought experiments, she blah 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 blah. But I also want to explain the argument that I gave in standard form was something that appears early in her argument and or in her article, and it accomplishes these tasks. It represents a pro-life view, it makes it clear what she is and is not denying, and so on and so forth. So that's basically all we're doing for paper one. The other two papers build off of them. So for paper two, you do all of the things you did in paper one, but in this case, you're adding more content. You're going to add an introduction to the paper, which I'll give further instruction on, and you'll also consider an objection or give an objection to one of the premises in the argument that you give. So in the first paper, you're just doing explanation. In the second paper, you not only explain, you also give your paper a little bit more body, including raising an objection, so critically examining an argument. The third paper draws from the prior two. So it can include the introduction from paper two, it includes the argument in standard form, the explanation of each premise, and an objection to your argument, but then it adds additional information, like answering the objection. Not just considering an objection, but reacting to it. And then a conclusion to summarize what you've accomplished. And so at the end, this is a standard philosophy paper where you introduce an argument, you explain it, you consider an objection, you raise a plausible attack, and then you answer that objection, and then you close it out to show everything that you were trying to accomplish in your paper. So this is all we're trying to do in this course for papers. We've got three different ones, each one building off of each of the previous one, and they grow. So now let's look at making an argument in standard form. So when we present an argument in standard form, the sole purpose is to be absolutely clear what we are or are not claiming and what we're trying to establish when we make those claims. So as a matter of example, consider the following argument. All men are mortal. Socrates is a man. What would follow from this? Well, that Socrates is mortal. Or consider another one. If an action terminates an innocent human life, then it is immoral. Abortion terminates an innocent human life. So what would follow? Well, that abortion is immoral. Now, notice for each of these, the basic structure is pretty straightforward. We've got two premises and then a conclusion in either argument case. As well, to determine which one's which, I've got 1, 2 to denote the premises, and then C to denote the conclusion. But then I also have this line in between the premises and the conclusion. This divisor is kind of like a line that you put when you do addition. If you bring in all these different numbers and then you add them, boom, you get the answer at the bottom. You can think of the premises and conclusion in a similar way. If you get these premises and you add them together, boom, line, then conclusion. And that's the whole point. You're trying to represent in the most clear presentation as possible the reasoning of your argument. Now, when we try to set up an argument in standard form, a lot of people don't present their arguments in that straightforward fashion, so we have to put it in that way. We have to take their material and fit it into this certain structure so that it's abundantly obvious what's going on. So, suppose you were to encounter the following argument. Life is not always better than death. For if life is always better than death, then no one would want to commit suicide, but some people do. Or no one would commit suicide, pardon me. So, this argument is pretty straightforward, I guess, but it could be even more straightforward. It could be more logically represented. And so, let's look at how we can break this down. Anytime we take an argument in standard form, you'll remember that on the previous slide, I had one claim per line. And that's exactly what we want to do. So if we're going to get one claim per line, then we got to break down this passage into their most basic claims, or what I'm going to call propositions. So we want to break down this claim, or this passage, by identifying the basic propositions that are involved so that we can put together all of the ingredients singly. So, how do we figure out how many propositions there are? How many propositions are in this passage? How can we break it down? Well, a generally good rule is to just say, well, how many sentences are there? How many independent clauses are there? So how many things can just stand alone by themselves? Well, that works pretty well for the first one. The first sentence, life is not always better than death, that's its own basic proposition. So by proposition, what I'm really getting at is a sentence that can stand by itself and is either true or false. So when I ask a question, my sentence, my interrogative sentence, is not true or false. If I say, like, hey, could you get me a burrito? My question's not true or false. The answer might be true or false. If I say, go get me a burrito, then that's not true or false. Somebody can't say, oh, well, that claim is false. Instead, they could say, no, I don't want to, or you're not the boss of me, or something like that, or I would happy to oblige you to a burrito. So there are many responses, but the exclamation or the command is not true or false. So any proposition that we're going to get in this argument, we're going to want to make sure that it's either true or false. So it has to be an indicative sentence. So what else do we have? For if life is always better than death, then no one would commit suicide, but some people do. Now, we're going to want to break down this one a little bit further. It's one sentence, but it's got more than one claim. So how many claims are in this sentence? Well, we've got if life is always better than death, then no one would commit suicide. And we've got some people do. Notice that you might be surprised by how I broke this down. I said, if life is always better than death, then no one would commit suicide. You might be tempted to say, life is always better than death is one proposition, and you'll have another one that says, no one would commit suicide. But what is really going on is the claim is that there's a relationship between these two claims. And so the proposition that I'm marking in number two is, the claim is conditional. If X, then Y. Or if A, then B. Where X, or A, stands for the claim, life is always better than death. And Y, or B, stands for no one would commit suicide. So, but the claim I'm making in two is conditional. It's a X is related to Y in this way. It doesn't say whether X is true or false. It doesn't say whether Y is true or false. It's just saying there's a relationship between the two. If one's true, the other one has to be true. That's a little complicated, but we can move on. So, but that last part, some people do, would be the last proposition. So I'm spelling out what do really means. Do is an abbreviated form of talking about commit suicide, right? Some people do. What do? Well, they commit suicide. So, sorry, this example is like super dark. I appreciate your patience. I'm supposed to keep it light, right? Anyway, so the third one is some people commit suicide. Notice that that's a distinct claim from everything else that's been said in this passage thus far. But now we have our three basic propositions, namely a conditional claim, that's number two, one of the claims inside of two, which would be like the Y or the B or something, the no one would commit suicide, some people do commit suicide, things like that. So basically fills that in. And we've got one. And one is basically what would be the equivalent of A or X. I'm using variables so that you kind of like simplify the structure as much as possible and just focus on placeholders like X or Y or A or B. So let's take the same passage and then let's look at the logical structure of this argument. So we've got our basic propositions. Let's move them around and identify exactly what they're doing in the passage. So the first thing you want to identify is the conclusion. What is the main point of this argument? What is it trying to show? What is it trying to prove? So what is this trying to accomplish? It's trying to establish one claim. Is it trying to establish that some people commit suicide? Is it trying to establish if then? No, it's trying to establish one thing, namely that life is not always better than death. This is the main point or the conclusion. Now this might surprise you because the conclusion is actually marked first, but the conclusion is not about a geographical or temporal relation. It doesn't say when or where it appears. Instead, it's saying logically that it follows from the premises. It follows from what is being claimed. So life is not always better than death is what they're trying to establish. And so we're going to put that right at the bottom. So now that we have our conclusion, we want to find out what are the other parts that support the conclusion. Now, you look at the rest of this, you've got, for if life is always better than death, then no one would commit suicide, but some people do. It's helpful to notice that there are certain words that indicate for us how they work logically. For example, the word for is a premise indicator. That is, it identifies whatever comes next is going to be a premise. So for he is a jolly good fellow is literally saying the reason why we're celebrating is because he's a jolly good fellow. So for, because, since, on account of, all of these are indicators what comes next is going to be a support. So what follows for is going to be a claim of support. Now, there are other ones that are called conclusion indicators. And this passage doesn't have one of those, but you're probably way more familiar with these. They're words like therefore, thus, so, hence, it follows that. And all of these are saying what comes right after I say this is the very thing I'm trying to establish. So you might say, like you could move life is not always better than death at the very end. And you could put therefore. You could say, if life is always better than death, then no one would commit suicide, but some people do. Therefore, life is not always better than death. So, certain passages, they might or might not have indicators. Where they're present, use it. But you'll also notice that there's this word, but, in there. And this is what would basically be called a logical connective. By a logical connective, It just means whatever came before this, I'm going to just continue that. So if whatever came before this was a premise, then what comes after is also going to be a premise. Whatever came before me was a conclusion, well then, whatever is after is going to be a conclusion. So right here, it's saying that after the four, whatever it is, which we know to be a premise, whatever comes after, but, is also going to be the same kind of support relation. So it's also going to be a premise. So, when we got four, we know that if life is always better than death, then no one would commit suicide. That's going to be our first premise. But the word but also tells us that we'll have a second premise. Namely, some people commit suicide. And that continues the same logical structure. Now, you might be, as I mentioned just before, surprised that I did not mention if and then. These are also logical connectives. So if, then, and, but, they do tell you something about the logic, but it's not going to necessarily be premise and conclusion. It's going to tell you the inner moving parts. So but continues whatever is going to be a premise or a conclusion. If and then just continues, like it shows a relationship between two different claims, and that can also appear in a premise or conclusion. So if, then, but, these are not going to be premise or conclusion indicators. They're just logical connectives. They're connecting or joining together elements of the same argument. So we've got our premise and conclusion indicators. We've got logical connectives. And now if you look at the bottom with those two green boxes and the blue one, we have a very straightforward presentation. If life is always better than death, then no one would commit suicide, but some people do commit suicide. So that follows that life is not always better than death. This argument form is actually pretty famous. Not necessarily this argument, but the structure of the argument is very famous. It even has a Latin name, modus tollens. I don't need to get into that, but the structure, it feels intuitively right. It seems patently obvious. If A, then B. But B isn't true. So then, of course, A can't be true. That's the flow of the argument here. So, let's go back. Now that we've got our propositions isolated and we recognize whether they're a premise or they're a conclusion, then we need to kind of just fill out the other details to make sure it's absolutely clear. And these are required elements of standard form. For one, the premises and conclusion must contain one and only one proposition. So in the first one, the only proposition that is involved is A is related to B in the following way. If A is true, then B is true. So it's just a conditional statement. It's one and only one proposition. The same with premise two, and the same with the conclusion. So I'm not sneaking in other claims. I'm just having one proposition at a time. So we're good there. But premises and conclusion have to be on their own lines. So I should not, like the original passage, just continue going on and let, you know, the side of my page break right. Instead, I want to have one line per proposition. So we're also good there. The last thing, or two more things, actually. One more thing is premises and conclusions get their own labels. So just like I had with Socrates as a man and all men are mortal, those are numbered with premise one, premise two, and so on. So let's do that here. Premise one and two, and then a conclusion, identifying what's going to be support, what's going to be conclusion. Because when you get to the paper, you're not going to color code it. You're just going to put a label saying premise one, premise two, conclusion, or P1, P2, C, or 1, 2, C. All of those are adequate as long as you're making sure it's clear which ones are premises, which ones are conclusion. So we're good. One last thing, we got to make sure that there is a line dividing the premises and conclusion. Just like you do with addition or subtraction or many other mathematical operations, That line distinguishes the ingredients from the product or the outcome. What goes in and what goes out. What goes in, premises. And then you go through our little logic machine and out comes this conclusion. Now, you might say, hey, but premise one is actually false. Well, that's fine. This argument was just used for illustrative purposes. But if the premises that come in are good, then our logic machine is going to churn out a good conclusion, provided our logic machine is well-oiled and fine-tuned. So when we get that line in between, it just identifies a clear distinction between the two. And it kind of makes it obvious that, hey, what we're doing is a process or an inference. So we're good here too. Okay, so for the first paper, what are we trying to accomplish? We're trying to explain an argument. And so I've spent a good chunk of time on an argument in standard form. So imagine you've got this paper, and the first thing you do is you say, hey, I'm trying to represent this argument that someone's trying to make that Socrates is mortal. And so you put it in standard form. You make it absolutely clear what is the logic and structure of the argument, and you put it in standard form, just as I have done. But then, the second step is you're going to explain each of the premises. So you're going to spend a paragraph or two to explain a single premise. So you might say for premise one, all men are mortal. And then you want to spell out what that sentence means. Well, every human who has ever lived has died. Well, at least everyone has a disposition to die. So human organisms are composed in a way that they propagate not by living forever, but by sexual reproduction. So everyone expects to die. This is what naturally happens. This is all what we mean by the word mortal. So I've just explained the first premise. It might be obvious, but when it comes to arguments that you're going to be looking at, there may be some technical terms, and you want to make sure that those technical terms are explained. Get rid of all jargon. But you also want to make it absolutely clear and explicit so that if somebody had never read the article, they know exactly what the author meant. They know exactly what the author was trying to communicate by premise one. And so you want your space, what you're trying to fill is you're just kind of amplifying or being a loudspeaker so that everything that the author said is said clearly, straightforwardly, and thoroughly. So you're going to explain each premise and they're going to get their own paragraph. I don't want you explaining two premises in one paragraph. You're not doing it. Not only does your paper suffer from coherence, but you're probably also not being thorough enough. You're not spending enough time making sure every word is absolutely clear. Like, for example, if somebody wants to explain how affirmative action works and so on and so forth in an argument, then you want to say, what is affirmative action? Just spell out what it is. Well, it's a policy that accomplishes X, Y, or Z. It tends to have these kinds of outcomes. So just take any term that has a technical meaning or a nuanced meaning and make sure it's used in a very clear way and spell it out in a paragraph. So, critical characteristics of a good explanation include that technical jargon must be de-jargonized. So all technical terms made non-technical. Say what you need to in three sentences, even if the author used one. I am okay with you setting aside conciseness if it means that you got it absolutely clear. Second, your presentation must be accurate and charitable. You may be representing an argument that you wholeheartedly disagree with, but that's okay. Your presentation must be accurate. You want to actually clarify what somebody else believes, what somebody else is arguing. It doesn't matter whether you agree. You want to make sure that it's absolutely clear that if the author had read your paper, they would go, yeah, they got it. They know exactly what I'm saying. And maybe they did it better than I did. You want to be accurate in that it nails it. It's exactly what the person was saying. But charitable, you don't construe what they're saying in a negative way or in a way that shifts what they meant to make it sound better than it was or sound worse than it was. You just want to be charitable. Be a sympathetic reader. Like, write what you believe the author meant. Third, avoid evaluating or giving your opinion at all. So in your explanation, I expect no opinions, no evaluations, no arguments against, no critiques, nothing. Present the other person's argument and save your criticisms for later. This is very hard. You might read somebody and say, well, I believe that abortion is permissible, and this author thinks that abortion is not permissible. Represent the author's position, no matter whether you agree or not. Next, you want to summarize the argument in its context. Namely, you want to say, this is what the argument was trying to accomplish in the broader picture. What is the author trying to do? Well, the author's trying to do X, Y, and Z, but they use this argument on the way. It is just why. So it fits in the broader picture somehow. So this argument, you know, all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore Socrates is immortal. Well, this argument is often given as a simple example in every textbook that tries to show what an argument is and how someone can present it in standard form. So this is why this argument has appeared, right? How does this argument function for the author's purpose? Because the argument may or may not be an argument that they, the author, holds. They may disagree with the argument, as we see with the case of Judith Jarvis Thompson, when she gives the argument that she's representing to be the pro-life position. Now, another way of presenting this is as follows. You want to, in the most straightforward way, abstract the basics of an argument. That is, give the basic detail of what the argument's about. Just like you would in, say, Google Maps, where you see the general grid of the roads, and you know generally what's north, and things like that. In the same way, you would want to have the propositions spelled out in a grid. Premise 1, premise 2, conclusion, and so on. And it should be clear which way's north. That is, what's the conclusion? Where is this heading? But when you get to the explanation of each of the premises, you're going to fill in the details. So what do the premises mean? Give so much detail that it's abundantly obvious exactly where you're at in the argument, what the author intended. Put some flesh on the bones. Explain all your technical terms. This is going to give a lot more detail than the basic gist of it. But last part is, you're going to want to zoom out. You're going to say, hold up, this little thing that we saw fits in a certain context. It fits in a broader narrative. It fits in a broader purpose within their paper, within the article that you're explaining. And at that point, you're going to see how it fits all together. What is the role that the argument took? And so you're zooming out. You're not going to get back into all the details of the argument anymore. You're going to say, in a very simple way, the argument that I just gave, it accomplishes these different tasks because the author tries to do X, Y, Z, blah, blah, blah. So zooming out, think of it like a 1,000-foot view or even higher. It's going to be simplified. It's going to, in some ways, you want to summarize what the paper or the article is about that the argument came from. So that means you have to know what the paper is arguing and not just look at that one simple argument. So if you took the argument from Thompson, if an action terminates an innocent human life, then it's immoral. Abortion is an action that terminates an innocent human life. Therefore, abortion is immoral. If you pull it out of context, it makes it sound like she's pro-life. But fitting in the context of the whole article, in which she's explicitly arguing against the pro-life position, you would be able to navigate how does this argument function for her purposes. It functions as a foil or a representation of her opponent's view. Meanwhile, in the rest of our article, she gives thought experiments, why it's permissible to abort, and she considers different objections and so on. And that, like, she gives ground to the pro-life position only for the sake of argument. So you just want to, like, zoom out, what's the article generally trying to accomplish, and then say how the argument specifically fits within the article. So, by way of review, first we looked at how all philosophy papers have certain goals and that they have to satisfy certain conditions like conciseness, clarity, and coherence. But we also described the structure of the assignments in this course, namely that each paper builds off of the one before it. And so the first one that we're doing, we're going to be expecting these tasks to show up in every subsequent paper. I also explained standard form, that is, how to represent an argument in the most straightforward, abstract way that is clear what the author intends. I also explained all of the relevant ingredients for standard form. Also, we looked at the requirements and an explanation, not just to give the standard form argument, but also to explain how each of the premises work, how they support the conclusion, what the premises mean, and so on. Lastly, we also talked about how an argument is going to be fitting in the article that you're evaluating. At that point, you're zooming out and saying, this is what the paper that I'm talking about generally accomplishes, and how the argument that I put in standard form fits within that paper. And if you have mastered the core three elements of clarity, conciseness, and coherence, and if you have mastered representing an argument in standard form, and if you have mastered explaining the premises and how the argument fits within the article, then you should get an excellent grade on the paper.